inspections. We had the south lot issue. More recently, of course, we had the dreadful fires to contend with, and I'm sure we all are suffering right along with folks down in Southern California now, watching all of those videos and things. It just is, it's such a reminder of the trauma and the tragedy. So a lot of activity, a lot of work. I really want to give kudos to Kelly and her stellar leadership team for all the hard work and all the support, because despite all of the activities and things that the board was involved in, I think the hospital and leadership team just kept their eye on the ball and kept their eye on quality and kept their eye on the patients, and it was great. It was really sort of an honor and a pleasure to be involved at that level. A couple of the positive things I think that have happened, the community outreach that we have embarked on has, I think, been very productive and has been a lot of fun, meeting people at Rotary and Kiwanis, and we have one more to do that I will participate in at the Women's Club. Doing the blogs have been fun and interesting. We've gotten a lot of very positive feedback about the outreach to the community, so I think that has really helped and is something that we need to continue to do. I look forward to being a member of the newly formed Public Relations Committee. I think that will be interesting as well. And Dave, kudos to you. One of the real pleasures has been being an ex officio member on the foundation. It has been really enjoyable to see the engagement of that group. They seem to have a lot of fun together. They enjoy each other, but their commitment and dedication to the hospital and certainly your leadership has been really a bright point. So thank you for that. With that, it gives me great pleasure to nominate Joshua Reimer to be the incoming chair of the board. Do I need a second, or just I need a second.
A second.
Then all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Congratulations, Joshua. Joshua will do a fabulous job, and I have promised him that. He's worried because he's not a nurse. Yeah, that's right, exactly. Well, I'll be here to help. I'll be here to back him up. So on that happy note, passing of the gavel. And I believe you will nominate the rest of the board, of the rest of the office.
Thank you, Jane. And I speak for myself, but I am sure also for everybody on the board in thanking you for two really amazing years, and I'm really hoping that I don't cause the same amount of trouble that you've caused over the last 2 years in the next 12 months, and that it's a calmer time. Also, it is an honor and a little bit scary for me to take on this role, not having anywhere near the depth of experience in healthcare that anybody else on this board has, either from longer-term board service or prior professional service. And I have already relied and will continue to rely on everybody sitting up here and down there for help along the way. So thank you for that, and thank you for the vote of confidence. So I think I can nominate everybody all in one fell swoop. I don't think there should be any surprises. One change from this year, which I think has already been talked about, I'd like to see Jane serve as the first vice chair, Peter as the second vice chair, Sharon continuing on as treasurer, and Bill as secretary. So I think we can do this all in one fell swoop. Can we get a motion?
So moved.
The second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
That has that's passed. Okay. With that, let's move to the Outpatient Diagnostic Center RFP, which was in the package. Kelly or David, are you going to say something, or is this a opportunity for us to ask questions?
Yeah, it's definitely an opportunity for questions, but I just wanted to go over the schedule, and there's one change that has happened, just found out about today. So the RFP deadline, the proposal deadline, is now January 11th. because as the questions have come in, they've done two walkthroughs with the three construction groups that were interested and passed the RFQ, the qualifying phase. So there's many questions we needed to get, or answers we needed to get back to them. So it's now January 11th. And then what happens is that we sit down with each of the proposers and talk about the, you know, select, hopefully, but talk about their proposal, give our input. So say one has one idea and one has another, and we decide that what's best is maybe a combination of those ideas. So we'll get back to the groups and probably go through another process of answering questions and negotiating, and then we'll select a contractor who then comes with an architect. And so this process, Peter, you guys did this in 2009, I think. Is that right? Yeah. And they had over a dozen proposers at one point and narrowed it down. We've got three. And that's, I think the qualification process was really good this time, meaning we had to have OSHPT experience. We had to have so many things, you know, that they had to meet criteria. So it has helped us narrow it down already. We're using Vertran and Associates for this phase. Kathleen Carroll's doing an incredible job. She works under Kevin Koss. And in talking to Kevin today, he said that once we have an idea of the group we want to bring in, then of course the board will make that decision. So we'll make a recommendation, you'll make that decision. And then, and this was Bill's question, so when do we actually get the project in front of you? It takes a while, so they'll have to do schematic design, which will be 3 to 4 months. So we'll be able to give a good number around April, and then we'll probably have to come back with the final after schematic design. So this takes a while. And we are fundraising for this already. Dave and I have, we have three, actually four pledges already, so we're very excited to move forward, and we've got a couple big meetings still this month. And so even though you haven't approved the project yet, we are raising money for outpatient diagnostics, and this money will be used for a CT no matter what. So we would still need to use this to get started, even if we were just going to do a really small project. So I know things are kind of happening at the same time. I think this is the right way to go, because what happened with mammography is we raised the money, and then it took us 2 years to get it in. And it's better if we actually can have something to show and, you know, get it through OSHPT, have it ready, and then hopefully start construction once we get all the money in. So that's the process, and I don't know if there's any questions about the scope or the RFP.
Okay. I imagine there are.
All right.
Questions?
So I didn't see that this was broken out specifically by priorities, but
right.
You have done that in the past.
Right.
And that was somewhat dependent upon the funding. Is that still your
approach?
Yeah,
so it's on page 2 of the RFP. We have the phases, which is the priorities. So phase 1 renovation, CT and ultrasound areas with staff break room, which is required. Number 3.
Can you show that on the screen?
Oh, sorry. And then phase 2 would be the renovations of the outpatient entrance and waiting area. Phase 3, the new
med. Sorry, I just didn't, I saw
it,
that.
It just didn't go, it didn't look like priorities.
That's tied to the dollars.
Yes.
So this is the priority that's
this is
tied
the priority
to the
list,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and so we just go down the list based on how much money we have until we get to
yes.
either the end or
and
something.
And you see that the first one is the SPC 4D study, because we will be required to do that for 2030. So
right.
We wanted to get that in. No matter what, we want to have that done.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I guess I appreciate your responsiveness and the detail of it to some questions that I raised offline, and I appreciate that we'll have a chance to look at this entire project scope, as you just mentioned. I was surprised at the range of the construction cost. That hadn't really been mentioned before us, I don't think. I'm sure inadvertently, mm-hmm. Even when Kevin was in here, his presentation didn't really mention the range of the estimated project cost, but could
yeah.
be.
Yeah, it was. It was in the document that we handed out. The the 15
Oh, in the handout, I guess it was.
Yeah.
Not in the, yeah, right.
I think you might, it might not have been in the PowerPoint.
It wasn't in the PowerPoint,
okay.
Right.
It was
so
in the handout.
I guess I didn't read the document, but I appreciate you now. I think it's a very thorough RFP, and I think it really gives us a lot to think about, I think, and in a positive way. So again, I'll probably have some other questions, which I'll submit to you offline,
okay.
Just about, you know, the business vision here and what it's going to do for our procedural volumes and that type of thing. So I'll
right.
bring them up at this point. You're
and
well aware of them.
Yes, we actually, Dave and I have been working on the case statement. He's been writing it. But we've been working with a number of advisors and other people who are looking at this with us to see to make sure that we have the business case in there. And I think we're coming along pretty well. So, again, this is a project where if we don't do it, we're going to get behind and lose business. So we want to maintain our business and then also have state-of-the-art technology with the CT going from the
right.
64 slice to the 256, the MRI improving.
Oh, yeah.
All of that should help us. But we're already at 70% market share. So that's really high. So of the people that can use us, we have a very good market share.
Right. Well, thanks an awful lot.
Okay.
So I have a couple. One, what is MEP systems?
Okay.
It's sort of the second thing on page two.
Yeah.
Evaluation.
I know, and I can't.
It's referred to a couple of times
there. Yes, it's mentioned in the one area. Can I get back to you on that?
Yeah,
okay.
And it was just I didn't understand.
Do you know
what? I have no idea.
I can't remember.
And then second, a lot of this is, or I assume a bunch of the money here is for things like the CT scanner and the new MRI and upgraded equipment across the, is there, and that stuff, we would do whether we did a reconfiguration or not over
right.
time because that equipment.
Well, and if we upgrade it, so for instance, the CT is in a very small room.
Mm-hmm.
So if we upgrade it, we would still have to do the construction to increase
to
the
room.
Space because it's too small.
I was just curious, out of the 15 to 20, and maybe this is unknowable at this time,
right.
how much of it is equipment
oh, we
versus,
know. Yeah.
Yeah, versus that?
The equipment is actually not that expensive. So the equipment is about $6 million. The rest of it is construction.
Well, that's expensive.
Well, considering the percentage of the
yeah.
total project.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when we think about construction costs, we're really talking about $9 to $14 million of construction costs.
So as you see in the RFP, we've tried to keep the budget under $15 million,
yeah.
And I'm hoping to do that. But yes, it
but
will be at
15,
least.
If it's 15, then it's $9
million. It'll be at least $9 million in construction.
Yeah.
And that's actually a lot lower. So when we looked at that, all that old space, about 2 years ago, right, Peter, it was estimated at $35 to $40 million to redo that entire
mm-hmm.
space, meaning taking it
right.
down and redoing
right.
the building. So it's
the
an expensive space.
Yeah, the observation is hearing $15 to $20 million when we talk about it in construction costs.
Right.
That's different to me than hearing it's $9 million in construction cost.
And $6 million
and
in equipment.
Because the equipment is sort of what we have to have, right?
Right. Especially MRI and CT
right.
are vital
right.
for us.
Anyway, so that was just my observation when I was reading it. Is I wonder if we're doing ourselves a favor calling it $15 to $20 million in construction costs.
Okay.
MEP is...
Take it for what it's worth.
Right. Well, you
Do you
might
know
say,
what MEP
yeah.
is? Mechanical, electrical, and plumbing.
So that's heating and water.
Thank
and,
you.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And those are component. Well, then let's call it the non-medical equipment.
Right. Right.
Costs.
Right.
And I don't know how much of those, and they might have different useful lives, but they become assets
mm-hmm.
of the hospital and the district, subject to amortization. So from an accounting standpoint, that runs against
depreciation.
Right.
Yeah,
that's what I'm
yeah.
saying. Well, depreciation or amortization, it's depreciation, it will go against the operating statement.
Right.
And I don't know how much, how those non-medical equipment assets, how they are capitalized on the balance sheet, because it's obviously, I'm not asking for the answer.
But you know the answer.
Because the construction costs include labor as well as
materials.
The materials. And it's the materials, presumably, that will have the depreciation.
No, they'll all get capitalized, labor and materials.
Labor, okay, very good.
All of it does.
So that's something for us to take into account and to be shown that, because that's, we'll be running against the operating statement, whatever
So, and that's a good point. So the last project was $46 million, and we added about $2 million in depreciation as a result.
Per year.
So it'd be about $1 million.
Right. Well, that is, we'll be looking for that number, just so that we know. And then, of course, the other thing, without getting into too deep, much detail at this point, is, you know, what's the maintenance cost of those assets, you know?
Incremental.
The incremental maintenance cost, whether it's increased utility bills or anything to do with those new assets on the balance sheet. It's not just the depreciation that will run against the operating statement, but also, presumably, and we'll yet to find out, some operating expenses. So,
well, the good news is usually for the first year we have no contract because it's under warranty, so we save a little bit because we do have we have contracts on all of our X-ray equipment. It's quite expensive, the service contracts, because we have to.
Oh, sure. Well, and based on this RFP, so well detailed, you know, I think all those issues will be answered.
Okay, but I'll, you know, and as we go through the presentation, I'll have you get some input on it before we bring it forward.
Other questions? Okay. The administrative report.
Okay, so we actually just want to mention that we have 4 stars again. We're one of the only hospitals that have 4 stars. We thought it was going to go down to 3 because we had a little blip with the C. difficile.
Can you say who awarded us the 4 stars?
CMS, so Center of Medicare and Medicaid Services, gave us the 4 stars again. And usually we get notified about the stars every October when they start their fiscal year. So that's when we found out. So we're pleased, and we're one of the few hospitals in the Bay Area that has 4.
Do we have, Peter, have you done or has somebody done the same analysis that we did last year, that you did last year, to sort of say we are one of 3 in the North Bay or 4 in the North Bay?
Yeah, thank you.
That's terrific.
Yeah, it really is. Also, the skilled nursing facility has gone through several surveys. They actually had to have 4 surveys. So they had they have the life safety after they have their regular annual state survey, and then we got revalidated. So they came in, CMS did a follow-up for another week, and they're still at 5 stars and doing very well. So pleased, and they've gone through a lot this month. So that's kind of the major things that are happening in quality. Rate My Hospital continues to be very good, and we're learning a lot and getting very good feedback, especially around the emergency department. The 3D mammography construction is a little bit behind because of the fires and also because of the contractors not coming in because they have the fire damage to deal with. So we're still hoping to have that up in January. And I wanted to, the salary increases, we actually have, we'll move forward with the budgeted salary increases, but a little less than planned. So we're going to do 2% for the directors and above and 2.5% for the staff and managers, and I think that that's reasonable. It does bring down our budgeted plan a little bit by about $500,000 of what we had planned to do. And we had input from the Finance Committee and Sharon all of this week, and I think everybody's okay with that decision. But I also want to mention that, and there's an org chart in here, a new one, that we did eliminate 7 management positions this past last Friday. Effective January 1st, and that gave us another $1.5 million as a result of the restructure. The staff forums were all held in November, and that was what we talked about, so I was very open and honest about the healthcare environment and what's happening. And I'll just mention Healdsburg Hospital has an interim CEO. They had a change. Petaluma Valley still has not figured out what they're going to do as far as the management group. Sonoma West, I sent an article to you to let you know where they stand. They've got to decide whether or not they're going to take back over the hospital. There are major layoffs happening at Queen of the Valley and at Santa Rosa Memorial. Kaiser's the only one who seems to be staying the same. I don't hear much about Sutter as well, but it's a lot is happening in the healthcare environment, and that is what I shared this past month with the staff, is letting them know that, you know, I don't want people to worry about job security, but it's pretty crazy out there now, and hospitals are responding. Even hospitals that had great payer mix, like Marin General. And Marin General just decided to reach terms with UCSF and do an affiliation. So there's a lot happening, and that's what I wanted to share with the staff this past month. And I think it went well. A few people left concerned because they don't worry about their jobs, and maybe they at least are a little more aware of what's happening in healthcare. On the new enhanced revenue strategies, Dr. Alexandridis did start. She's the general and breast surgeon, and picked up a few GI cases as well, which is helpful because we did not have anyone dedicated to our hospital to do gastroenterology. And the women's place will kick off in January with her as kind of our main marketing unit. And conversation of with the doctor was over the top. We couldn't believe all the people who signed up to come in and do this. So we found another way to reach the community that is of interest. People wanted to come see Dr. Sadel, and we'll have more doctors doing that. And then I just want to mention that surgeries are up 25% over last year, which is very good. This was one of the things we were talking about this last time last year, was how are we doing on surgery, and we have done better. We actually have the South Lot sale, the deposit. The first one has been made, and I think the second one is due in a couple days. So those will be in that escrow account. Yeah. And then the home care is reducing expenses. We worked with Kaiser on a new contract, and the result was that we didn't get very far. So home care will no longer be taking Kaiser patients. And that was a significant portion of their business. And so now they're making the adjustments. And most of that will be announced December 14th. A number of people will not be working in home care that used to. And they're aware that this is coming because we just don't have the volumes. We have to adjust to the volumes. They're also decreasing their space. So they're going to stay off site for now, but they're taking less space because their new lease is renewing. And they're going to go to month for now. There's a new cardiologist that was hired, or will start this summer, with Dr. Price. His name is Dr. Alex Renault, and I hear good things. So that'll be great to have two cardiologists in town. And let's see. I don't know if Barbie mentioned this when Barbie Robinson was here, the whole person care plan, but that is actually going forward. It is in front of the Board of Supervisors, I think, next week. And that is a way to help. It's supposed to help in the Valley, too, anyone who's homeless get the medical services they need. So those are the main updates. I just want to mention this scorecard. We shared this with our potential partner, and we are actually a quality looking really good. I think the falls will be back down under 2.5. We had one patient who had a number of falls. And if we can get through January without a C. difficile outbreak, which is what happened last year in January, we should be okay and have that back up. FTEs per AOB is a number that lots of hospitals look at. We were really low in October, and that was because of a lot of people didn't come in for the fires.
Mind you define AOB?
Adjusted occupied bed. Thank you. Yes. So as we've been talking about, the inpatient discharges continue to be lower than expected, although I'm hoping that this month, as December, will pick up. And we've been closing the ICU more than usual because that's a very costly unit, so we adjust as these patients come in. So I think the ICU has been closed at least 6 days this past month. And that's the way to do it. Births are also not anywhere near what we expected, although they're back up a little bit in October to the average. And I don't really have anything more to say about the trended numbers here. So the main thing is that we had a difficult quarter, bad quarter, the first 3 months, that where revenues were not where they expected, and so this is the change we made. So we have less chiefs. We have basically Don Kuahara and Mark and I are the only three full-time chiefs that are going to stay, and also Face and Diego. Sarah, who you'll meet next, is taking over all of accounting, and so we eliminated the controller. We also eliminated the chief quality officer. Leslie Lovejoy is going to go to part-time, and she's going to do a few things while she trains our new quality and risk manager director. So there's been a lot of questions and concerns about how many managers and directors. I think this is about as the lowest we can go without having just no managers in the position. The span of control is pretty large, as you can see for Mark and for me, with both of us having a lot of direct reports. And I did give Lynn McKissick, who's doing a great job, food and nutrition services, so she's over that department and she'll do really well with it. Okay. Any questions? Okay. You're up.
I need to turn them.
Yes.
All right. And your spots.
Close.
All right, so I'm going to start on page 2 of the finance report. And I'm going to take a look at the payer mix first. You can see with the different payers, we are pretty close to budget. With the Medicare's, we were at 58.8% versus the 55.3% budgeted. Medi-Cal was the 17.1% versus the budgeted 17.8%. And for commercial, we were at 19% and we had budgeted 20.5%. So overall, they're pretty close to budget. For the cash activity for October, we had the collection goal at about $3.5 million. And we collected roughly $3.8 million. So we were over the goal by $380,000. The year-to-date goal was $14.6 million, and we've collected $15.1 million. So year-to-date, we are at $471,000. At October 31st, the cash on hand was 12.5 days. And this also doesn't take into account $1 million that we got from the parcel tax that we put in the money market. And so that is roughly an additional 7 days, so we 19.5 days at October 31st. The accounts receivable days at October 31st was 45.3, and the accounts payable days are at 48.3. And so next I'm going to look at Schedule D, the statement of revenue and expenses. And for October, the gross revenue was under budget $2.6 million. And this really reflects the wildfires that we had and, you know, stopping the outpatient services for, was that a week and a half?
Yes.
The outpatient surgeries and services. And so when you take a look at the revenue deductions, we were better than budget by $2.3 million. And that just has to do with the lower gross revenue. But we also received additional IGT funds of $496,000. And you can see on line 32 that we did not have to put up any additional matching funds. It was just extra funding that came through. So that really helped a lot in October. And so on line 20, you'll see that our total operating revenue was $271,000 less than what we had budgeted. On line 33 for the total operating expenses, we were better than budget by $341,000, and that was primarily due to the salaries and wages. Just for a lot of employees were not able to make it to the hospital during the fires and so forth. So that was better than budget by $266,000. We were over in supplies, close to $14,000, and that was in lab and dietary, and we're kind of reviewing that in finance to see why that came up. And then after accounting for all the non-operating and non-operating expenses and revenues, we come down to the net income of $61,788 versus the budgeted net income of $19,498, with an EBITDA of 5.5% versus the 3.9% budgeted, and the EBITDA of 4.4% versus 3% budgeted.
This may be for Kelly as opposed to Sarah, but as we watch what's going on in Washington with the budget, the tax plan, mm-hmm. and it looks like they are going to remove the individual mandate. Mm-hmm. Have we done any modeling or thought at all about what the impact is going to be, particularly on payer mix?
Yes. So I'm actually going to a board meeting tomorrow with Hospital Council, and I'll hear more about what the projections are. But yes, we'll see Medicare go, or Medi-Cal go back up, mm-hmm. if people don't have insurance. I'm sorry, Medi-Cal go down, bad debt go back up.
Self-pay.
Yeah.
But we don't have any.
Well, we know what happened when we didn't have the Affordable Care Act. We were at about 12% Medi-Cal, and now we're at 17-18%, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that'll be the change.
Have we been able to find either our own experience or any of the other hospitals why the first quarter was so low on inpatient?
So we are hearing from many hospitals that it was a very quiet quarter. So we're not the only one. But as far as knowing why, our main analysis shows that less patients are qualifying for admission and less patients are being admitted from the emergency department. But one thing that Dr. Cohen has been working on before he retires is we're analyzing all of the transfers to make sure that there's patients that we could keep. Are we keeping them? And some of our new emergency physicians, because there are many new emergency physicians, are not as comfortable keeping the patients at the hospital than others were. And also the hospitalists have to accept the patients. So we've been meeting with Dr. Streeter, who's the hospitalist medical director, for quite some time. And we've agreed on four, almost five types of admissions that we will always keep at the hospital that sometimes are being questioned of whether or not we should. The hospitals will accept them, and that's important. And then also cardiology is an area that we need more support. Dr. Price has agreed to come in on any patient and make sure that those hospitals have that backup of a cardiologist. Because if they don't feel they have the backup, they're not going to admit the patient. But all the hospitals I'm hearing have been down in census. And I know a couple are not going to make their budget for this year as a result of it.
It's just unusual, the quarter that the downturn hit, because the biggest change in insurance occurs 1st of January.
Right.
And, you know,
and this time last year in the summer, we were actually higher than we expected. So it was not, it was definitely low.
You know, you go back a number of years, it's never been a downturn in the first quarter.
Not that bad, for sure. No. Yeah. But to get a patient admitted, it takes a lot now. You have to be really sick.
But that's been true for 2 years.
They're more and more stringent on authorizations, especially Blue Cross and Blue Shield.
Okay, so they're playing the game.
And United Healthcare as well. Yeah, well, again, there's less insurance companies. They've all consolidated, and they're tough. And if you guys are interested, Cynthia Denton would be great if you want to bring her in and have her speak to you about payer mix and what's happening. And I think that would be good to hear. Okay, we'll do that.
Back to your comments about home care. What was Kaiser's, did they have any reaction to us no longer caring for their patients? They just signed on with another agency and that was that, huh?
And they used their own agency, their own staff, which is more expensive than ours. It makes no sense.
Interesting.
But I wish I could understand Kaiser better. I don't. I know I talked to at least a dozen different people in the process. Lots of decision makers, or lack thereof.
Thank you, Sarah. Any other questions for Sarah Kelly? Committee reports. It says you, but I think it's Peter.
Was originally passed in 2011 with the goal of making it less time-consuming for putting the minutes together. And it's, as we've gone through several board clerks, the practice changed a little bit. So I went back to Stacy and said, look, your minutes right now are wonderful. Would you go ahead and revise our policy to reflect what you're doing? So that at least in the interim, while Stacy is going to play mom, whoever does the minutes can use the exact same formula. So that this particular guideline policy is a reflection of what we're actually doing right now. And although at this point, I'd like to go ahead and move that we approve the new guidelines, because that's what we're doing. So.
Second.
Aye.
All right. And the second policy that we brought forward is the add one more comment. One of the things that we discovered in terms of going through the policy on the minutes was if at the direction of the board we make recordings of the minutes, you have to keep them for 30 days. Now, we don't have to keep the television, but they are saved.
Archived.
They archive them and they're on, but we don't have to worry about whether they do or they don't, because that's not necessarily at our direction. But these little recorder here that we are using to make sure that when the board clerk does the minutes, it's a very effective way of being able to go back and reading, so that we will from now on keep that recording for either 30 days or until the board minutes are passed or approved, so that we've got a record of what we're doing. On the media policy, finally found at what meeting we passed the original media communications.
Can I interrupt? Do we have that policy on committees? Because we're recording
right now, right, Stacy?
Right. We could address that.
Yeah, I think you can make a case for saying that you'd, it would probably be a good idea.
It seems to me, especially since they're coming here to be approved.
Right. Sorry. Since they're coming here to be approved, that we might, while we're doing this, we might want to include the committee minutes.
So one complication is I think it's a longer lag sometimes for the committee minutes. It's not just 30 days.
That's okay. I mean, so I don't think it's going
right.
to, will that be of concern, Stacy?
I keep them generally, but for the Brown Act, they only have to
be 30
days.
So they only have to be kept 30 days per the Brown Act, but she does keep them, is what just was said.
You can, okay. The.
We have to decide which one we want, because it's been kept 30 days or.
I think until approved.
If you want to parse the wording of the California Public Records Act, It's only if the recording is being made at the direction of the district board. And for the most part, each committee runs their own show, so it would not, I think you can make a case that we are not obligated to.
But I think it would be helpful because sometimes we do have, as you point out, lags in and questions about what took place and going back to it. We could make a separate statement,
okay.
Not so that we don't change the state regulations.
Easy to do.
Exactly.
On the media communications policy, we found finally the policy was originally put on the agenda in January of 2014. We didn't get around to approving it until December. So I went through and, having found the old one, it had a lot of references to, we were basically giving direction to people that work for Kelly. And it seemed like that would tie her hands if she wanted to make changes in terms of who was doing what in communications. So I went and stripped out those areas where we were giving specific direction to people that work for her. But the policy portion of it that shows up on the first page is virtually identical to what we passed in December of 2014. And the procedures are taken out of the old policy. So that this reflects a very little change from the old policy, but it's just cleaner and easier to understand. The one area that we are giving specific instructions for a hospital employee, and that is that the I retained the paragraph that says hospital employees shall not make statements to media or through media on behalf of the hospital or board without authorization from the CEO or the board chair. So, you know, we are telling people that work for Kelly in that particular paragraph. And it seemed like, you know, it would be that that's something we needed to do. The other thing that, having heard last month the presentation of how we handled the hospital during the fire emergency, I, you know, we had no mention whatsoever that there is a public information officer during a emergency. So I added a paragraph to, you know, if we do have another emergency in any future time, specifically hospital employees and board members would be restricted to any communication would be through the emergency public information officer. And that makes sense because it's awfully easy to have almost all the information, but not quite all of it. This just basically makes it a little less chance of error. And I think that's, you know, that's basically the gist of it.
Any comments or questions? A motion?
So move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Board comments.
Just a reminder that we changed the January meeting from the first Thursday to the second Thursday, so it'll be the 11th because of the holiday. And on behalf of the board, Stacy will not be with us next month, so I want to wish Stacy and new baby girl all the best. We will be anxiously awaiting good news and pictures and all of the above, but want to wish you the best and hope everything goes very smoothly, and we look forward to having you back as soon as you are able.
Is that a HIPAA violation if you're giving out the names?
Can I patient? Put a potential patient? Anyway, best of luck. I hope everything goes well.
Other comments?
Yeah, last Sunday, as we all probably read, there's this planned acquisition by CVS of Aetna, and that certainly is a very dramatic playing out of the transformation in the healthcare industry, broadly defined. You know, I think CVS has some very limited services available in their store here, but if you read their press release about the acquisition plans, they certainly intend to widen the services that they offer. And of course, Aetna therefore becomes a good cross-sell for them with the insureds that they have. So a lot of dynamics there are obvious. That's certainly among the macro challenges that we face of the non-incumbent providers getting into our space, if you will. And we're all aware of that. But it did remind me of the meeting that we went to in Phoenix at the Arizona Biltmore almost 3 years ago. which was that AHA Excellence in Governance. And one particular session really stood out to me, which was called Surviving and Thriving in the New Commercial Environment. That was quite interesting. A lot of it centered on the insurance aspect and a lot of things related to finance, what have you. But the presenter, Sam Glick, ended up with talking about, again, non-incumbent providers. And he waived the special issue of Time Magazine that had come out that week, which had pretty straightforward discussion of all of these challenges, people who are going to get into it. And I asked him for that slide deck. So the last page, the last slide that he put up was quite revealing. It listed Walmart and Aetna was on it. CVS wasn't on it. Google, Rite Aid, Target, Walgreens, Amazon. So all of these non-incumbent providers are going to get into our space. And, of course, we have one of them here. So I know that Kelly has some strategies in mind that we've talked about, so look forward to that. But the macro changes are upon us.
In terms of one, I think it's related, but SCAN no longer has CVS on their preferred provider pharmacy. They've got Rite Aid, and I can't remember who the other two, but CVS is
Rite
conspicuously
Aid and CVS
absent.
Are owned by the same company. Just interesting.
No, Rite Aid and Walgreens.
Walgreens. Right. Right. I think that's right.
Any other comments?
I think in U.S. News and World Report today there is no news of another merger, but I can't remember who it was. But it was somebody buying up a doctor's practice.
It was, they bought a DaVita physician practice, and who bought them? I read.
The dialysis company?
Yeah, the dialysis company. But it was a big physician, gosh. Yeah. I can stop and Google it, but I can't remember either. But it was the DaVita physician group.
It's interesting that hospitals aren't allowed to hire doctors, but I suspect they can.
So I just had a couple of comments myself. One, I want to thank Kelly and Ken and Sarah and the whole team for, and the finance committee, for actually getting ahead of what, you know, the financial challenge that the hospital has faced this first 4 or 5 months. I was really struck by how proactive that was and is, and I know how difficult it is to seemingly restructure and downsize an organization. That can be very, very hard work and very challenging. And so I just wanted to thank you for doing that and keeping us ahead of the game, unlike some of our compatriots around the state and other places in the country that are not being as proactive and I think keeping themselves as healthy as they could be. So thank you. And I also wanted to mention, I was back in the hospital today getting an x-ray for my rib, which is still bothering me. And I had another really, really wonderful experience with a minimal weight, really pleasant, nice people and very competent people. And it just felt like a really good place to be. And so thanks to that team and everybody for that. It felt really good. And certainly nobody recognized who I was, so in my gym shorts and whatever. They were not thinking. And then I'm looking forward to, I'm hoping everybody can be there on the 15th in our meeting, our closed session meeting, but I am very much looking forward to that, and I think it'll be really interesting. With that, any other business?
United Health bought DaVita, DaVita physician group. And the DaVita CEO is saying, we are already looking for new investments after the $4.9 billion sale.
So they sold the dialysis business or the physician?
The physician group.
Wow.
That's what it says.
Well, let me mention another patient testimonial, since you were testifying here. A friend of mine who remained nameless, patient in the hospital, says in a message to me just a couple days ago, they were here in the here in our wonderful hospital. This person had two knees replaced and went straight into the rehab downstairs. And the care at all levels has been more than one would dare to wish for. So compliments to your staff.
And everybody I know is really anxious for the 3D mammography unit. They're quite disappointed at the delay.
Also, Department of Health Services has a new system where you have to go through a centralized group and get assigned whether or not you can get your licensing. You have to be assigned, and you have to have an analyst agree to look at it. We put in our application in April. We still have not had any luck in getting anything assigned. And they said they were 6 months behind, but this is 8 months. So there's another delay, probably. We've gone to as high as we can with the Department of Public Health. And they said, I'm sorry, we just don't have enough analysts. So hopefully we will get this in February.
Fortunately, Peter's mic was off. Okay, I think anything else? Then I get to bang the gavel.
Yes, you do.
Here's the there we go. I'm doing it right. Meeting adjourned.
At 815 West Napa Street. For more information, you can go to sonomapaintcenter.com. And Larbroy Automotive, located at 18155 Sonoma Highway. For more information, you can go to larbroyauto.com. Underwriting is provided by Sonoma Paint.